Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Father, we just come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. How good it is to be in the house of the Lord. Lord, we want to remind ourselves and also make this statement that we're not here to hear from a man. We're not here to hear from a woman. We're not here to hear from a tall man, short man, old man, young man. We're not here to hear from a white man, black man, brown man. We're here to hear from the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, and guard us. Direct us and motivate us to be all that the Father would have us to be, and all that the Son paid the price for us to be, and all that you, Holy Spirit, empower us to be. And we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. How good it is to be in the house of the Lord. But Lord, we're not asking that you just bless us. We want you to bless all the churches in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet, that are preaching, hearing, teaching your gospel today, your word. Bless our Baptist brothers, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest, Oak Valley and Oasis and Inland Christian Center. Thank you, God, for the great churches that are all over preaching the gospel. Lord, we want you to know that we're not better than them, but we're co-laborers, workers in one field, building one kingdom, and that's yours with them, Lord. And we thank you, Father, for a great move of your Spirit everywhere. In Jesus' mighty name, when everybody says with a great big shout, amen. And if you've got your Bibles, go ahead and take your seat and let's go to the Word of the Lord today. You know, what we've done is we go line upon line, precept upon precept in the Word of God. Last time, many years ago, when you were probably not even born, most of you, I taught the book of Hebrews. It took me 4 years, not 4 days, not 4 sessions, not 4 weeks, not even 4 months. It took me 4 years to teach an in-depth understanding of the book of Hebrews. We are now past that time as we do it again into our 5th year right now, and we're only on chapter 11. You'll remember last time that Pastor Dan did such a brilliant job in bringing us something called the paradox of our faith. Paradox means weird things, means strange, opposite. You wouldn't think it's that way. Quite crazy, if you want to really say. Here we are, strangest people on the planet. My goodness, stop and think about it. You're believing in a God you haven't seen. You're believing in a God most you never heard from and heard of. You didn't walk the Calvary Trail with him. You haven't even seen Israel, most of you. Don't have any concept whatsoever yet. There's something on the inside of you that believes the paradox of life. That's what makes us different than the world. We're in the world, but not of it. Paradox is something like this. You must die in order to live. You must give in order to receive. Doesn't make sense. Paradox is the seed goes in the ground and dies before it produces life. My goodness, what's that all about? Dies before life. Strange things you believe as a Christian. Almost crazy things if you really stop and think about it. Someone walking on water, opening the blind eyes, speaking to the deaf and their ears open up, raising the dead to life. These are all paradoxes. These are things that are strange and weird to our natural minds. And yet, when we go and approach the Word of God, oftentimes the Word of God will tell us to do something that's just contrary to our thinking, contrary to our feelings. May I say it like this? Contrary to natural, logical understanding. But there's just something on the inside of us that says, oh my goodness, it's real. It's truth. I just know it to be. For most of us in here, we find ourselves in a place, in a dilemma, oftentimes in our walk as a Christian. And that's what church is all really all about, is that you come in and you learn how to get out of those dilemmas, those problems, those situations that you're in to become strong so you can go through the valley of the shadow of death, coming out on the other side, prosperous and successful, and church helps you to do that. And as we start to look at the Word of God in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, today I'm going to back you up a couple of verses from where Pastor Dan left off, and I'm going to take you to verse number 10. If you're making notes, you might as well write this down, because here's the title of the message: when it becomes time to just wait. A lot of us don't understand that it's oftentimes what God calls us to do before we receive a promise. You start to believe God for something. You pray about it. You might even have found it in the Word of God. And you know that God spoke to you on the inside about something, and wow, it just didn't come to pass. It's not happening. It isn't something that is, you know, quickly responsive, and you just have to be in this waiting pattern. And I find for most Christians, in this waiting pattern, they get discouraged. In this waiting pattern that's part of life, that we get frustrated. When between the time that God, you spoke to me, and the time that it actually comes to pass, oh my goodness, it's that period of waiting that is the most critical to see where you're really at with God. It's actually, the Bible describes it as a testing time. A time where God's going to see where your heart's at, and you yourself are going to see where your faith is at. Oftentimes we'll believe God for something, and it doesn't happen overnight. Has anybody ever had that happen to you? It doesn't happen when you think it ought to happen. And it doesn't certainly happen in the way that you think it ought to happen. We start believing God and it just doesn't take its time and it just doesn't happen and we get frustrated. I'm here to make a statement to you, and you need to hear the statement. What if I told you today that waiting time between the time you started believing God and the time you received is some of the most valuable time of development you will ever have of your heart? I'll show you that today. It's not the easiest time, believe me. It's not something that is we just easily have. We're a society of give it to us quick people. If our cell phones aren't fast enough, we get mad. If our computers aren't fast enough, we go online and find somebody who can speed it up, and they made a fortune speeding up your computer. We want fast food, and we want it hot, fast, in 30 seconds, or give me my money back. And then after you taste it, you say, give me my money back and take your time. You know what I'm talking about. Everything is fast nowadays. In fact, some of you are in here today hoping that the sermon will be just fast. God forgive you. We're always looking for something fast, when in fact, part of your relationship with God is a trust factor, and it includes a time called waiting. Abraham went through all of that, waiting how many years before Isaac was really born. Didn't have a lot of years left, but he had to wait even in his old age. How about Joseph? How many years? 15, 17, 18 years in prison. From the time God gave him a vision to the time that it manifested itself and became part of the promise. How about the children of Israel? 400 years in captivity before they broke free, were able to be free. How about David, for an example, in the scripture? For years, probably 15, 12, 12 13, 14, 15 years before he ever became king. After he was anointed by Samuel to become king. Oh my goodness. Waiting is something that's part of our life. I don't know about you, but I hate to wait. I want to hear my prayers answered immediately. I can hardly wait to go to a church which says, I prayed and got healed the next day. I prayed and I got a better job. I started tithing and immediately I got a raise on my job. How do you know? That's a great thing to hear, but it's not always for all of us. Sometimes God calls us to wait. In the 10th chapter, we see Abraham, as he's called out by God to go to a new place that he does not know, and he's looking for something because there's a promise waiting for him. In verse number 10 of the 11th chapter, I'm sorry, in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verse number 10, put it up for us, and let's take a look at it. It says, for he waited. And he waited. And he waited. For a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God, he was waiting. And it's very common to see that. One time I was met by a lady at the back door a number of years ago, and she came to me and she says, "Can I talk to you?" I was greeting people. I said, "If you wait until all the people I greet are over with, then I'll be happy to come talk to you." She waited for me, and I went to her, and I could tell she was probably in her 40s. She said to me, she says, "Pastor, I'm so discouraged. God told me I was going to have a husband. And I've been waiting for that man. I know he's a man of God, and I know he's coming, and I don't know. Maybe I missed God." I said, "How long have you been waiting?" She told me it was quite a while. And I quoted a verse to her. It's an interesting verse. It's found in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse 36. I'll put it up on the overhead for you. It says, "For you have need of endurance." One translation says patience. "That after you have done the will of God, you'll receive the promise." After you've done the will of God, you receive. I kept repeating, "After you've done the will of God," I kept looking at her. And she says, "Pastor, I have done the will of God. Why, I'm in church all the time, every church service. I'm a volunteer in children's church. I tithe, I study my Bible, I pray. I do the very best I can to be honorable before God. And I'm getting so discouraged." And I opened my mouth and I said something. You know, sometimes pastors say things and they have absolutely no idea what they're saying. It just comes out of the mouth and it comes from the heart of God. And I'll never forget what I said to her. I said these words. I said, "Did you ever think that the will of God was for you to wait?" And a lot of times we don't believe waiting is the will of God, when in fact, all through Scripture, we see people who waited for the promise they have come from God. Yeah. Almost everybody in here right now is believing God for something. Some of you are believing God for healing, but your pain keeps going on. Some of you are believing for a better marriage, or maybe that husband coming around, or that wife coming around. Maybe you're believing for the children that have gone astray. Maybe you're somebody believing for a better job or the finances to turn around. Whatever it is that you're believing God for, from the time you started believing God for it until the time you received it, there's a waiting period. And that waiting period is a development of your character, so that when you receive it, you receive it and know it's from God. And God's not in any hurry. He never promised he'd bring it on a certain day. He just said it'll come. And waiting is very important. When you can't do anything else but wait, then may I say this to you? Learn how to wait the right way. I have four things that God gave me to give to you. Four simple things to do so you won't be discouraged. Because what happens is you get discouraged and frustrated, then your faith gets weak. Instead of being strong, your faith gets weak. And that's just where the devil wants you to be, that your faith is weak instead of strong. That's where he wants you to be, so that you back off, so you never receive what God told you to receive. And I have some things that'll help you stay strong during that waiting period. And the reason I know this, because Debbie and I have lived this all of our lives. When you're a pastor, you're always waiting for something to happen. Waiting for the church to be filled, waiting for people to get saved. Gosh, waiting for finances to pay the bills every month. You're always waiting for something. And then you get into business later on in life, like I have. Until I hear from the voice of the Lord, I've started a business. I'm not going any further with that business till I know God's on board. I'm waiting. I don't care. He's made a promise to me. How it comes about is going to be as I wait on him. And it's a tough time to wait on him. I found four things that are really interesting in Scripture that you ought to do, and so do I, so that we can wait on God a little bit. So I don't want to just tell you need to understand about waiting. I want to share with you how to wait. Is that okay? Because what good is it for me to point out to you about waiting and not know how to wait? And we do that too many times in American churches. We tell people what to do, but we don't tell them how to do it. And today you've come into the house of God, and prayerfully you're going to hear from the Holy Spirit on just what to do so that you can wait properly until the time comes, so that your faith will be strong even when it comes, and keep in there, hanging in there, not letting discouragement whittle away at your faith. Today you're going to learn. First thing I love, and I love this, is how to wait for God. Number one, entangle yourself in God. A lot of times we're waiting for God to entangle us. Oh God, make me this. Oh God, make me do this. Oh God, make me this, make me that. And God's already done it. And he's telling you, now it's time for you to take the initiative and you to do it. The Bible says if you'll draw near to him, he'll draw near to you. Notice the first step is you're drawing near to God. And for all of us, we have an option in life. You can entangle yourself. You can entwine yourself around. You can get caught up in. Is that a good expression? You can be somebody who is involved in. Is that another expression? Something else other than God. And eventually your faith will no longer be on what you heard the promises to be. And that's exactly the plan that Satan has for you. And you need to entwine yourself around. You need to entangle yourself around. Sometimes every single hour of the day. Listen to what I'm going to say to you. You know, if you're sick and you have pain in your body, it doesn't let up. Have you noticed it keeps on and keeping on? It keeps on and nagging and nagging and nagging. And as much as it nags you to get you off, you ought to get on God to get on. Is anybody listening? It's very important for us to entangle ourselves. We make the commitment that whatever it takes, morning, noon, night, in between, I'm gonna entangle myself. I can entangle in the world. I can entangle in thoughts of men. I can entangle in ideologies and philosophies of people. I can listen to what my relatives say or what my friends say, what the boss on the job says. I can entangle myself with politics as crazy as they are right now. But guess what? I think I won't worry about the politics. I think the best thing for me to do is entangle myself with God. Therefore, I can stay strong instead of weak in my faith. Because you'll find out one thing about Abraham. The Bible says he was not weak in his faith. Therefore, he was strong. Listen to what it says in Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, in the 40th chapter. Go there with me. Isaiah, the 40th chapter, makes a brilliant statement from the heart of God about this subject. And in verse number 31, familiar for some of you, new to others, let's talk about it. It says these words, but those who wait on the Lord. Wait a minute. I love the first two words, but those. Did you know what but those means? That means you, 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 all of us, but those. In other words, it's wide open for all of us. It doesn't mean just someone special. It's not just for the Billy Grahams. It's not just for the pastor. It's not just for the preachers. No, it's for any one of us that wants to do something, that'll wait on the Lord. And then he goes on and says this will renew their strength. I love this as you read this, because in order for my strength to be renewed, what he's saying is at one time I had strength, and now I have it gotten out of it, and I have been discouraged, and my strength is weak. And when my strength and faith is weak, all of a sudden, but here it says, renew their strength. They shall mount up like wings, like eagles, and they shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. This word wait is an interesting word. In the original text, the word wait means to have patience, yes. You would understand that. To have endurance, yes. To endure, yes. To be long-suffering, in other words, you're suffering for a long period of time. There's stuff coming against you, pressure's coming against you, you don't see the results. It means all of that. But it means something else. It means a entangling, a twisting together. You say, I don't understand that. Well, let me explain it like this. Debbie and I like to sail. We're both sailor. She's actually a licensed sailor. And so we like to sail. I'm not crazy about it. We're crazy about God. But in order just to take a break, we go sailing sometimes. There's something on a sailboat called ropes. You know them, but they're really not called ropes if you're a sailor. They're called lines. Never call that a rope. You call it a line. And if you look at the lines, they're very interesting. They hold thousands upon thousands upon thousands of pounds of pressure, because each little particle, each little string that's in there, each little nylon thread type thing is woven around each other in such a way. Then it's woven again around another one, and it's woven again around another one until it becomes one strong line that holds it very tight and holds it in place. And that's what he's describing here, is a winding around. Not by yourself, not winding around something of the world, but winding around God, twisting around so you take your small little part and you wind it around his part. And then all of a sudden you're stronger than you've ever been. Why? Because now you're entangled with God. And you do something, your strength, instead of it being weak, will be renewed. Powerful. Did you know that you have an option to do this or not do it? In the New Testament, there's a warning. If you'll go there with me in 2 Timothy, the second chapter, let's take a look. And it says something about us being, if you will, army of God. And we're enlisted in the army of God. In 2 Timothy, the second chapter, let's take a look at it together. And let's see something of real importance for all of us to benefit, if you will. In the second chapter, if you will, in 2 Timothy, in verse number 3, it says this. Second chapter, verse 3, 2 Timothy. You therefore must endure hardship. You therefore must endure. I don't want to endure. I don't even want hardship. I hate that hardship stuff. And I hate the endurance stuff. I want it fast. I want it now. I want results instantly. Here it is, God. I want my prayers answered. I do not want hardship. I do not want endurance. But that's what he's talking about. That's where we get the word endurance from. He says you must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. But the next verse is really fascinating. Listen to what it says. We're talking about entangling ourselves with God. Verse, it says, and no one entangled in warfare. Boy, aren't you in a warfare? When you're believing God and you see no results, you're in a warfare. When you don't hear from God and you say, God, where are you? Can I make a statement to you? When you ask God, where are you? Can I say this to you? You got to understand this. God has never moved. The reason you don't know where he's at is because you've moved. That's not an amen. That's an oh my goodness. I don't like that one, you know. When you're entangled in warfare, listen, anyone engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of the world. No one entangles himself with the affairs of this world. You can entangle yourself with the ideologies and philosophies of your day. They'll pat you on the back, tell you you're wonderful, right on, and miss it completely. Or you can entangle yourself with God. Remember, what we're talking about is so important for us. We're talking about how to wait for God. Number two, here's the second thing God gave me to give to you. You ready? Here it is. Listen to this. You got to practice godliness. You will never be godly because you've been made godly. You'll be godly because you're made godly and you practice. Did you know that everybody practices? Anybody that's good practices? The tennis player practices, the fly fisherman practices, the surfer practices, anybody that does anything, the hiker, the climber, they all practice. They know how to do things. When I was a young man, I wanted to be a professional baseball player. I'll never forget it. And I was so dedicated to baseball in those days that I would literally have to practice all the time because I wasn't as good as everybody else. And what I would do is I would earn money by mowing people's lawns and cleaning up their yards and earn enough money that I could take the money and listen to what I did with it. I would pay people to catch me. Yes, I would say, don't go to the beach today. I'll give you $5 if you catch me for an hour and a half. And they would catch me. They'd put on a catcher's glove, you know, and get down behind a plate, and I would pitch at them, and I'd practice. In fact, I was such a fanatic about it, I even talked my mother into catching me. She was a character, man. She was really a sports thing, and she put on the baseball glove, and she put on that catcher's glove. She put a rag in there, and she'd catch me. I couldn't throw but half speed to her, but it doesn't matter. I still practiced a poise. I practiced how I did things. I practiced my push. I practiced, you know, became a professional baseball player for a few years, only played in the minor leagues. What you know the team is a Kansas City, Oakland Athletics. In my day, it was a Kansas City Athletics. I was one of the first years I ever wore the gold-green uniforms. Still have a picture of that. Not my office. I don't even know where it is. But yet at the same time, everybody that's going to ever do anything, practice. Have you ever thought about, because God made you and washed you with his blood, made you godly, but you got to practice it. And I find that when I practice godliness, I have a strong faith relationship with God. When I don't practice godliness and I'm doing things other than that, I have a small, weak relationship with God. When I'm holy, I feel like, man, devil, look out. But when I'm sinning or I'm in some area that's contrary, that's why I need church, because in church, I get built up strong to keep on going. But when I stay away from church, I find myself in a place of doing things, saying things, watching stuff, doing stuff I should not be doing, and it drags me down and my faith gets weak instead of strong. And then I need to renew by waiting on the Lord, twisting myself together. Practicing godliness is very important. Psalms 37th chapter. In Psalms the 37th chapter, it's kind of a really cool little expression. It's almost like one breath at a time. Verse 34 of the 37th chapter of Psalms says it like this. Wait on the Lord. The same mouth, same expression, the same breath of air. And keep his ways. And keep his way. Wait on the Lord and keep his way. The rest of the verse says, and then you'll get the promise. You got to practice. In order to get in church, you got to practice. Because everything in the world will try to come against you to keep you from church. Ever notice things? I won't go this week. I went last week. It's unbelievable. We're in the army of God, which I have time to tell you this little story. Can I tell you a little story about Pastor? Pastor's at the back door greeting people as they leave after his sermon. And he says to this guy, he sees this guy, he hadn't seen him in a long time. He says, man, I think the last time I saw him was Easter or Christmas. I don't understand this guy. He says to the guy as he goes by, he says, hey, but let me tell you something. I need to talk to you. Can you wait for me until after I greet all these people? And he says, yeah. And the guy's thinking to himself, what does this pastor want from me? What's he want to tell me? The pastor walks up to him afterwards and says, you need to join the army of God. And he says, what? Pastor, what are you talking about? I am in the army of God. He says, no, you're not. He says, I haven't seen you since Easter. I haven't seen you probably since last Christmas. You only come a couple times a year. And the guy scratches his head and thought for a moment and says, well, Pastor, you don't understand. I'm in the Secret Service. I want you to know we have too many Secret Service people around here. And if you're going to stay strong in God, you're going to have to practice godliness, and church will help you to do that. Somebody give me a great big amen. Will you do that? Number three, let's talk just for a moment. Number three, we're talking about how to wait for God. Number three, listen to this. Continue to expect godly results. If you don't continue to expect, did you know that God is waiting for somebody who is expecting results? He's looking for them. You can't give up. You got to expect they're coming. Today may not be the day, but tomorrow might be. Tomorrow may not be the day, but I'm a day closer. You got to expect godly results. You can't give up on what you're believing God for. You can't just back off and make an excuse and justify why your faith has gotten weak. It's not God that's gotten weak. It's your faith that's gotten weak. And God was just trying to say, so you got to expect godly results. What's fascinating about that is, tell you a little story I read about a guy who was swimming the English Channel. He wanted to set a record. It was a long time ago. He had a little boat next to him as he took off, you know, and the boat was like the referee or somebody who was kind of watching to make sure there was no cheating going on or anything. He was going to set a new record. And if I remember correctly, the English Channel is 23 miles wide, but it's some of the most treacherous water in the world, full of, if you will, stinging things like, what are those fish called? Jellyfish, full of sharks. The current was terrible. All the time it goes in different directions. The waves, the cold. Many people have lost trying to do that in their life, swim the English Channel. The guy starts off, the boat takes off from the shore, and he's doing pretty good. Hour after hour, boring as can be, swimming, hour after hour after hour, and he keeps on going, and all of a sudden something happens to him. A fog comes in, and he loses his direction, can no longer see it where he's going, does no longer have an idea where it is that he's supposed to end up. He keeps on swimming because he's diligent. And he swims for another hour goes by, another hour goes by. And he's saying to the boat, he's yelling, now he's lost the boat. He knows the boat's there and he can't see the boat. The fog's gotten so thick. And he yells back at the boat. He says, I don't know where I'm going. I think I'm just swimming in circles. And he keeps swimming for another hour. And then he finally yells at the boat, are you there? And they said, yes, we're here. We can hear you. He said, well, pick me up. I'm finished. I can't swim this. I don't know where I'm at. I could be swimming back to where I started. They picked him up, put him in the boat. He was 50 yards away from making the land and making his goal. 50 yards. Some of you have been in a fog when it comes to the things that God's promised you. Some of you have been in a fog and you've been swimming and you think in circles when in fact you're closer than you think. And if you give up now, you'll never get it. And sometimes the harshest, hardest times come right before. The hardest attacks come right before you receive the promise of God. My friends, listen to me right now. You've got to always expect godly results. God's looking for somebody who expects results. Go with me, if you will, to John 5th chapter. John the 5th chapter, there's some interesting verses about Jesus. Jesus in John the 5th chapter is making a statement that is so powerful. If you will, I wanted to read it to you because I want to start with this and let you know that Jesus is now entering into Jerusalem, and as he enters into Jerusalem, there's a pool called Bethesda. And this pool is a pool of water. Debbie and I have been there with very sharp, very steep shoreline. There are a bunch of steps going down. In those days, they called them a porch. It was like steps, like this would be a porch that goes down into the water. And that would be called porch. And let me read to you something that's very interesting. In verse number 2, it says, now there is in Jerusalem by the steep gate, a sheep gate, a pool, which is called by the Hebrews Bethesda, having 5 porches. And in these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed. So in these steps are just a multitude of people, thick, waiting to get healed. Notice the word waiting in your Bible. What are these people doing? They're waiting. Why are they waiting? For the moving of the water. The next verse tells you what happens. Verse number 4. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water, and whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. But verse 5 tells us an insight. Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. I'm talking about expectation of godly results. 38 years. This man was probably lame and he could be seen by people. Verse 6. When Jesus saw him lame, no. When Jesus saw him dancing, no. When Jesus saw him praying, no. When Jesus saw him, listen to the word, laying there. What was he doing there? Waiting. Waiting for what? To get in the pool first. Why? He was expecting results of being healed for 38 years. What caught the eye of Jesus was someone waiting for results. And you and I, my friends, have got to wait for results. It's in that waiting time that the heart is tested. It's in that waiting time to see if you're going to back off. It's in that waiting time that develops you. It's in that waiting time that tells about your character before the heavens. It's in that waiting time. Listen to what it says. The sick man, Jesus, Verse number 6, lying there. And he knew that already that he had been in that condition a long time. And he said to him, do you want to be made healed? Well, the sick man answered and said, sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I'm coming, another steps down before me. Jesus said to him, rise, take up your bed and walk. Verse number 9. And immediately the man was made well. Guys, God's looking for somebody who will sit by your pool, even if it takes 38 years, and expect godly results. Yeah. Number 4. Last one for today. I love this. Here, let me review them. You're going to have to, remember, you're going to have to entangle yourself with God. You're going to have to practice godliness. Number 3, you're going to have to continue, listen to this, with great godly expectation for results. But I like number 4, stay away from grumblers. Oftentimes, that's you. Are you hearing me? People who grumble get what they grumble about. Listen, let me say this again. People who grumble get what they're grumbling about. Case in point, children of Israel coming out of 400 years of bondage in Egypt. They have seen everything. They've seen every miracle you can possibly imagine. They've seen the plagues. They've seen the water turn into blood. They've seen the frogs. They've seen the boils. They've seen the cattle die. They've seen the animals die right before their very eyes. They've smelled the stench of the whole thing. The miracle after miracle after miracle to sway Pharaoh to let his people go. Oh my goodness. Then Pharaoh finally has it when his son is dead and all the firstborn of Egypt is dead. Finally he throws up his hands and says, get out of here. And they leave. And when they leave, they go to cross the Red Sea. And I love the miracle God has. As they're crossing the Red Sea, the Bible says they crossed on dry land. Oh my goodness, God not only opened it up, but he dried out the land. Whew, that's amazing. And then as they crossed the Red Sea and they got to the other side, the Egyptian army is finally frustrated enough to go after them with their chariots and with all their people. And they chase them into the Red Sea and the sea closes in and kills and destroys the entire most powerful army in that area, the Egyptian army. The people shout and cheer that God is on their side. God covers them at night with a pillar of flame that keeps them warm in a cloud that air conditions their walk during the day. God takes them and they start within one day, they start to complain. Moses, you're going the wrong way. The promised land is over there. Why are we going over here? Moses, where's the water? Moses, where's the food? I'm telling you, why is it that God brought us out of Egypt in the first place? Why, just so we could die here in the wilderness? Was there not enough graves back in Egypt? Oh my goodness, grumble, complain, grumble, complain. Listen, when you grumble and when you complain, what you're really doing is saying, I do not trust the control of God. Is God not in control of everything? Is God not in control of time? Or does time control God? If time controlled God, then time would be a greater force than God. God controls time. Time's in his hands. Everything that goes on. Even if in the life of Job, you remember that? Satan couldn't attack Job until God gave him permission. Yeah. My friends, when you complain about life, your boss, your job, the freeway, the children, the husband, the wife, lack of answers to your prayers, oh my goodness, and you make the statement, God, where are you? I don't like this at all. What you're saying is, God, I don't trust your control. In fact, the most interesting thing takes place in Numbers, the 16th chapter. Go there. Here we find that people are rising up and they think they're rising up against Moses and Aaron. They're complaining against Moses and complaining against Aaron. And notice what it says in Numbers, the 16th chapter, it says these words that are so amazing to me in verse number 2. And by the way, they rise up against Moses. And let me set the scenario for you so you can understand about how complaining works and how it defeats you along your path of waiting. Listen closely. They think they're coming against Moses. They think they rose up against Aaron and their leadership. That's the way they saw it, but God saw it differently. And this is what's so important for all of us to see. And it's so interesting. They said, listen, Aaron, listen, Moses, you take too much on yourself. You know, we're all in with God. God works through all of us. You don't need to exalt yourself whatsoever. So Moses says, well, let's just check out who God's side you're on and who God's on my side or your side. And he makes a statement before all of Israel. He says, if God does something spectacular, takes these grumbling people, opens up the land, and they fall in alive, their children, their animals, their valuables, their worth, their tents, everything. The ground opens up and exhumes them, and they're alive in the pit. Then we will know that God's on with me. If it doesn't happen and they live a full life out, then we will know that they're right. Let me read it to you. Let's go back to 16th chapter, verse number 2, and it says, and they rose up before, now listen to these words, so chosen so correctly. They didn't say they rose up against. They rose up before Moses and some of the children of Israel. 250 leaders of the congregation, representatives of the congregation, men of renown, they should have known better. They gathered together against Moses. They gathered together against Moses and Aaron. And said to them, you take too much of yourself, and all of the congregation is holy, every one of them. And the Lord is among them. Why do you exalt yourself above the assembly of the Lord? And Moses heard it, and he fell on his face, and he spoke to them, and he tells them the story of what's going to happen. They think their complaining is against Moses and just Aaron. But God didn't see it that way. I'm going to jump you ahead now. Watch this. Verse 30. But if the Lord creates a new thing and the earth opens its mouth and swallows them up with all that belong to them, and they go down alive into the pit, then you will understand that these men who complain have rejected the Lord. In other words, God saw it differently than they saw it. They said, we question God's authority by coming against you and grumbling against you. And exactly what happened to them, the land opened up, they were swallowed up alive right before their eyes. As they were alive at the bottom looking up at this chasm, it closed back up, never to be seen again. Don't mess with God. Number one, you got to understand this. Don't mess with God. And when you complain, you get exactly what you complain about yourself. They said, shall we die here in the wilderness over and over and over? We could have died in Egypt eating good food. And they died in the wilderness because of their complaining, never allowed to go into the promised land. The next generation, 40 years later, got to have it. What's God saying to us today? Waiting time is valuable time. It's not bad time. It's the will of God time. It develops you, character, and your faith, and it makes a statement to all the heavens and all of the earth. It's one of the most valuable times of your existence with God. In order to stand and be strong, you're going to have to every day entangle, number one, yourself in the Lord. Number two, you're going to have to practice godliness. Practice it every day. I have to practice this. Here's a situation I could be ungodly about, but I'm not going to. I'm going to do this. Practice godliness. Number three, I'm going to have to expect every day godly results. I got to expect it, even though I don't see it today. Maybe I'll see it tomorrow. And if I don't see it tomorrow, I'll see it next week. And if I don't see it next week, I'll see it next month. If I don't see it next month, I'll see it next year. Whatever it takes, God, I'm on your side. I am not judging. I'm not criticizing. I'm not complaining. I'm not getting weak in my faith. I'm staying strong in my faith. I'm staying in there with you, God. I'm believing you for great and mighty and marvelous things. And the day will come when I'm going to receive it because I'm expecting great, powerful, wonderful things. And then shut your mouth to complaining. Always complaining, nagging, negative about everything. That's a slam against God that says his control is not really his control. And you can complain about his control. And what you complain about will come upon you. Ugh. That should make you real happy. Because I quit. I'm finished. And if you got something from God, tell the Lord that. Come on. Woo! Isn't that good? Wow. Real quick, we never like to close the service without making sure everybody's okay with God. You don't get okay with God because you come to church. You don't get to go to heaven. Let me say it like this. If you want to go to heaven and you don't want to go to hell, then remain seated and listen to what I'm going to say to you. And by the way, thank you all for not getting up. Nobody got up and left except for a couple of people. But thank you for doing that. It's very respectful of the Holy Spirit. Let's talk just for a moment. How do you get to heaven? Let me share with you how you get to heaven. Jesus tells us this way. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. You can't get there my way. We can't get there your way. We can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way. We're going to have to get there his way. And he tells us exactly how to get to heaven in the scripture. Goes to the cross, dies so you can do it. Now he says it's your call and your choice. And he says these words, you must be born again. No, you can't get to heaven because you're good. You can't get to heaven because you think you know Jesus. You can't get to heaven because you call yourself a Christian. You can't get to heaven because, you know, you go to Easter and Christmas services. Let me tell you something. You get to heaven because you're born again. Most people attend American churches don't know what born again means. Born again is two words that Hollywood and movies and magazines and television has made a bad word. Like, if you're born again, you're crazy, you're a fanatic, you're a weirdo. That's not what Jesus is talking about. Don't listen to Hollywood about that. To be born again means this, that you have given God all of your heart, you have given God all of your life. He came to this planet, he gave you all of his heart, he gave you all of his life, didn't hold anything back, went to the cross, beaten, bloody mess, paid the price for your sins and mine, and guess what? Now he's waiting to see whether or not you will accept him. You don't accept him with mental ascension towards him. We all know who Jesus is, or you wouldn't be here today. That doesn't make you a Christian. Worst thing somebody could have said to you in your life, do you know Jesus? And you said, yes, I do. And they said to you, oh my goodness, that means you're a Christian. No, listen to me. That's not how you become a Christian, by knowing who Jesus is. Stop and think about it for a moment. Even the devil knows who Jesus is, and he's not a Christian. So the fact that you know who Christian Jesus is doesn't make you a Christian. How you get to heaven is you must be born again. Born again means this, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, you've given God all of your heart, you've given God all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. All or nothing, and I'll prove it to you, all or nothing. Last book in the Bible, you've heard the book of Revelation. Jesus himself is speaking. He says, and when I come again, and you know he is, you just don't know when. He says, when I come again, I will better find you hot or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. What did he just really say? He really just made a statement that lukewarm Christians, people who call themselves Christians, that are lukewarm are not real Christians at all, and they're going to get vomited from the mouth of Jesus, not going to be able to be accepted. What's lukewarm? Little in, little out. Tell me if this fits. Lukewarm, little up, little down, token prayer, occasional church attendance. Watch this. Tell me if this fits. You know, you're not against God, but you're really not wholehearted for God. That's lukewarm. You know, God is something in your life, but he's not everything in your life. He's just another something in your life. And God will never take that. It's an all or nothing relationship. That's what the scripture talks about. Somebody needs to love you enough, respect you enough, honor you enough to tell you the truth and stop playing games. I'm not here to throw smoke and incense all over you. I'm here to tell you the truth exactly the way it is. You must be born again. And the only way to get born again is you have to give all of your heart. You have to give God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. And if you haven't done it in this safe and friendly place, you need to do it. You say, well, Pastor Jim, how do I do that? Well, let's do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. That's what Jesus said. So in a moment, I'm gonna count to three. I'll go like this. One, two, three, and I'll pop my hands together. Bang, when you hear that sound. Bang, your hand goes up, I'll see your hand go up, and you can put it right back down. Is that okay? Hand goes up, I'll see it go up, man. And you, what you're saying by the raising your hand is I want Jesus not in my head like most Americans. I want to give him all of my heart, give him all my life, be born again, headed for heaven, and denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'm a man, I'll see it. He says, if you confess me before men, I'm a man, I'll see it. I'll confess you as mine before my Father. Wow, that's a blunt, bold statement. Tonight, you're gonna have to get your hand up all over this place. Who should raise their hand? If you've been running from God instead of to God, hey, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, I'm speaking to you. You're one of those people that have never given him all of your life. You know whether you have or not. I'm speaking to you if you've never done that. If you're one of those people that are not sure, make sure. Today is your day of salvation. If you, maybe you prayed with Billy Graham. Maybe you prayed with a Harvest Crusade. You know, you said a prayer. Do you think God is so stupid in heaven that he says, oh, they just spoke the right formula of words, formula, and called it a prayer, and now that gets them into heaven? Listen, he watches your life that follows your heart to see if the prayer is real. And your life speaks where your heart is at. Today is your day of salvation. Not just cheap words, but giving God all of your heart, giving God all of your life. Gonna go for God the rest of your life. Gonna go for God and be what God would have you to be, doing what God would have you to do. And we'll help you to do that every step of the way. You'll fall, you'll fail, you'll trip. We're a church, we'll pick you up, we'll love you, brush you off, take care of you, provide for you, meet your needs. We're here. We understand what those few days, few months, few years are like in the beginning until you become the rip-roaring Christian that God's called you to be. But today you're gonna have to make this step of faith. You say, Pastor, you want me to raise my hand? Forget it, man. I don't be embarrassed if I raise my hand. People I came with will see me. People behind me will see me. I'll feel funny. Yep, you might. Get over it. It's better to feel funny for a moment in a safe place like this than to be in hell forever and ever because you care more about what people think instead of what God sees. Come on. No one's that stupid, but God is telling you now to get your hand up, but the devil thinks you're stupid telling you not to. Today is your day. Tell the devil to go take a jump at a flying ghost because you're not going with him. You're going to follow God. Come on, somebody. I'm going to count to three, pop my hand up, and let me see how many of you are going to be bold enough before God and before heaven. Who cares what people think? And get your hand up because you know you need to get right with God. Today is your day. Ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Back over here. Thank you. Thank you. 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. Thank you. Back over here. 21, 22 in that family room. Back over here. 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? There's like 29 or 30. Anybody else? I see you back there. God bless you. Another person. Thank you. 30. I think you were number 30. I counted you twice, but I love counting. I can go to 31. Anybody else want to raise their hand? Thank you. Raise two hands. God bless you. You're 31 and 32. 33. God bless you. Going for God. Who cares what your neighbor says? You're going to stand before God all by yourself. They ain't going to be with you. Where's the next person? Where are you? Where are you? Back over here is another one. Thank you. 34. In the foyer. 35. 36 in the foyer. God bless you. Man, is anybody excited about that? Come on. Hey, wait a minute. What kind of a church are you that the preacher preaches too long and 40 people get saved. That's like insane, man. That's like insane. This place is rocking and rolling. Thank God that Jesus is in his house and he drew you home. Here's what I want for all 35 or 40 of you. Why don't you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible friend? I want you to get your stuff. I want you to bring a friend if you need to bring a friend. If you don't, tell them to sit there. Who cares? You're coming. I want you to get out of your seat, get in the aisle, meet me right here in front. Let's all stand and welcome them. Come now. Come, 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 come. If you raise your hand, you're serious about God. You come right now. You come, come, come. Come on, give the Lord a great big praise. Come on, yeah, it's good. Come on, they're still coming. Woo, they're still coming. Come on, home. Oh, they're still coming. Give them a hand as they come. You come too. Come on.
Just taste the living water.
Ain't God good? Well, thank God you guys have come. We're just excited about you coming here. I want to point out something. Put a smile on your face. This is a good thing, not a bad thing. You know, you're not going to the morgue. You don't have to look that way. You could be happier going to heaven. And by the way, like Deborah says, your angels are having a time in heaven right now. They're rejoicing that you finally did this, you know. Hey, this guy, look over here to your left. See this guy waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. He's going to pray with you, give you some free stuff, tell you about a program we have, keep you strong and healthy. We want to work with you to get to become a strong Christian. So, man, you got saved here. Let us help you go forward with God. You need to do that. In other words, the devil's going to suck you right back to where you came from. You don't want to do that. You want to push forward, go with God. Let us help you to do that. We will. Make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right over this way. Come on, Lord. Come on, people. Give the Lord a great big praise. Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.